I'll sit right here. Everybody will sit.
I say you just fine.
All right.
I'll say happy Father's Day to everybody. And I like this song, Lily of the Valley. Anybody familiar with it? Let's see if we can do it here. You know the words? Sing along. I'm not sure what it is in the hymnal, but you know the words? Sing along. I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see all I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. Fairest of 10,000 to my soul. I try that again. Lost my place. I found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, and him, O Lord, I see. All I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow, he's my comfort. In trouble, he must stay. He tells me every care on him to roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. Amen. He all my grief has taken, and all my sorrows borne. My strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken, and all my idols torn from my heart, and now he keeps me by his power. Through all the world forsake me, and Satan tempt me sore. Through Jesus I shall safely reach the goal. He's the lily of leave me, nor yet forsake me here, while I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna, he my hungry soul shall fill. Sing with me. This weeping up to glory, to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. Amen.
Amen.
Lily of the Valley.
Amen.
PowerPoint, I'm not sure. I don't have a clicker, so I might.
Do you have to hit a button?
Yeah, maybe if you hit the mouse. I'm not sure. Sometimes they have a little clicker button back there. I couldn't find one. Good morning to everybody.
Good morning.
Happy Father's Day to everybody. Glad everyone can be here. We miss the ones who can't be here this morning, but we'll be praying for them. And, hope they have a good time spending time with their loved ones. But I'm so thankful that you all are here. This morning I want to look at the book of Genesis. Prayer to Father's Day sermon. The Lord has laid on my heart. We come from the book of Genesis this morning. So if you have your Bibles, if you would, turn with me to the book of Genesis. And we'll be looking at chapter 18 this morning. This is chapter 18. Read a few verses there. Looking at somebody who was named Father, exalted Father, and then he has name changed to Father of many. Abraham, or Abram, whose later name changed to Abraham. Look at verses 18 and 19 this morning. Look back up to verse 16. And it says, "And the men rose up from thence and looked toward Sodom. And Abraham went with them to bring them on the way. And the Lord said, Shall I hide from Abraham that thing which I do? Seeing that Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him. For I know him, that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord, to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he hath spoken of him." Let's bow our heads in prayer. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for all the fathers who have taught and disciplined their children. Lord, we thank you for our fathers, Lord, who have taught us to love and showed us by a living example of how to walk the Christian walk. Lord, from those who have been blessed to be with Christian fathers, Lord, I pray that we can also walk and be a Christian example to others. Lord, I ask protection and care for all those who couldn't be here this morning. Lord, I pray that their time is used successfully and that they constantly remember you this day. Everything they do. Lord, be with us at this time. Lord, open the ears and hearts to receive the message. Lord, speak through me what we need to hear, giving us encouragement, hope, and strength. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. So how does one become a man? You know, I think that's a cultural question. You've seen Native Americans, sometimes they'll take one of their youngest kids and tell their boy to go out to the woods and leave them there throughout the night. A lot of times they put a mask on them, not knowing, you know, what the wilderness might be about them with all the different animals. And once they successfully pass that journey, they can come back and they're a man. They're accepted to the tribe as becoming a man. And so in our society, what do we see as a man? When does a boy reach manhood? Is it by growing a beard like I have? The bigger the beard, the bigger the man you are. Is it by building muscles? The bigger and stronger the guy is, then he's a man. Is it learning to tie a tie? You know, I remember my dad taking me into his room and I had to learn to tie a tie. So every time I tie my tie, I think of my dad. I do, to this day. Every time I tie my tie, I think of my dad. He taught me a certain way to tie a tie. That's about the only way I know how to tie a tie. I know there's probably 20 different ways you can tie a tie. You got bow ties, you got long ties. There's different ways you can tie a tie. But I remember my dad teaching me how to tie a tie. Is it by learning to tie a tie that one's a man? Is it by hard work? Working hard, and then you become a man. The harder you work, the more a man you are. About those who necessarily don't work as hard as you do in your mind. Maybe they sit behind a desk. They're not out there. They're not pulling weeds or doing construction. So is he not a man because he doesn't work the same type of trade as you are? And then we also hear different things about masculinity, about the way we raise up a boy. We tell him, don't cry. Boys, don't cry. Or the competition that we have in society. That you have to be a competitor. There is no prize for second place. You have to win. Is that what it takes to be a man? You always have to be a winner. And then I think about those who grew up fatherless. And how can they know how to be a man? And unfortunately, there's so many nowadays who grew up fatherless. And I see in the Bible, I ask my question is, what does God want? What does God the Father want? Have you ever asked yourself that question? What does God want? I learned growing up learning in seminary that God has no desire. God doesn't lack anything. So he doesn't have necessarily the wants. That's a theological point of it. But we see here that God forms a family. We know that we are adopted as sons and daughters into God's family. It's his purpose. And so we see here in Abraham that he has a purpose to build through a nation, which will later become Israel. And so I just ask myself that question, what does God want? And I see him building a family throughout the Bible. Building a family. We see that we are created in God's image, that we are to represent what God is, what he's like. Love, light, goodness, mercy. And so I also ask myself the question, what does a father want? To be a father means what? How does one become a father? By having a child, right? That's just the definition of the word father. Father is one who has a child. What does a father want? You know, when you try to get your dad something for Father's Day, what would you get him? You know, I remember buying some pocket knives in the past. You know, I'd get to a store and I saw a pocket knife with a little fish on it. I said, I'm going to give that to my dad. And then for a few years after that, I kept on giving him a pocket knife, you know, every Father's Day. Then he had probably six or seven of them. I said, well, maybe it's now time to kind of change it up some. He's got enough pocket knives now. So what do you get your father? What do you get him for Father's Day? What does a father want? I'd say a child that he can be proud of, knowing that he instilled the values into that child, that he did the best he could to raise up a child, and he sees that now that child is able to be successful. You know, that they live those Christian values that he's taught his child. I saw through the Bible the very first instance. In the very first pages of the Bible, it says that God is a gardener. Right? If you think about a trade that you would instill to your son, maybe you're a carpenter, maybe you want to show your son how to deal with wood and to pick up that trade. You know, that's a lot of times that's what they used to do until all these different businesses and stuff came along and now you kind of pick and choose. But remember, the way of the world was that whatever your father did, the son would do. He'd pick up the trade. So here I see in the very first pages of the Bible, God is a gardener. It says that he planted a garden in Eden, and there he put the man he found. And he put man there for what? To take care of what God had given him, to take care of the garden. So that's the very first instance that I see in the Bible that God gave man responsibility. Responsibility. That you're responsible for what God has given you. He said he put him in the garden to take care of the garden. Responsibility. Like I was just saying that there's so many kids that grow up fatherless who deny or neglect that responsibility. So I ask the question, what has God given me to take care of? Whether it be a job, family, children, a wife, home, the skill that he has given you, the talent, the trade that he has given you. What am I responsible for? What is my garden? What is my portion? What is my lot that God has given me? You know, in Colossians it says, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord. And you're not working for your employee or your employer. You're not working for anybody else. Your sole purpose is working as you're working unto the Lord. And so when I lay my head down on the pillow, I can say I've done my best for the day. Through all my relationships that I've come in contact with, through my job, the people I've come in contact, is that the best that I've done to my ability? As I'm working for the Lord, that God is my employer. I am his employee. Just like the Adam relationship there in the very beginning. That God was the one who planted the garden. And there he put man to take care of it. What are you responsible for? What's my responsibility? What has God given me to take care of? We know that neglecting responsibility has its consequences. Neglecting my garden. What happens when you neglect the garden? And that's what the Bible says there in Proverbs. Proverbs 24, verses 30 through 34, it says that he looked at somebody who neglected their garden. And he said that weeds had grown up and it was covered in thorns and the stone wall had been broken down. And so I see that as neglecting responsibility. So, I titled the message, Happy Thought. We'll get to that. The role and responsibility of fatherhood. You're responsible. You're responsible for being a father and for growing in that role and that responsibility of being a parent. Whether you're a father or a mother, understand this is Father's Day. So we're responsible for being father or mother, to raise our kids upright in the way of the Lord, just like it says here in Abraham. For I know him, in verse 19, for I know him that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord, to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he has spoken. You know, I see a crisis happening in this country about how kids are raised up. And I was looking at the psychology of it all. They call it a Peter Pan syndrome. Anybody ever read about Peter Pan? The boy that didn't grow up. He didn't grow up. They call this the Peter Pan syndrome. It's men who have never grown up. The responsibility. God gave man responsibility. Yep. With Peter Pan syndrome, I think it should be like responsibility. Yeah, there's the Proverbs about the garden growing up. There it is, Peter Pan syndrome. Peter Pan. Dressed in green. Peter Pan. So the Peter Pan syndrome affects people who do not want or feel unable to grow up. People with the body of an adult, but the mind of a child. So they don't know how to or don't want to stop being children and start being mothers or fathers. Peter Pan syndrome. ability to grow up. And it says there's an increase. There's an increase in numbers of, they see these young adults having these problems. That they're emotionally immature. That they're unable to grow up and take on adult responsibilities. And they even dress and enjoy themselves as teenagers. They, you know, they dress in what they would like a teenager. You know, they stay in that frame of mind. They never grow up. They don't want to accept responsibility, and they don't know how to. They say that one of the causes for Peter Pan syndrome is overprotection of parents. I'll do this for my kid, and I'll do this for my kid, and I'll do this for my kid. I'll never teach them the essentials of what it's like to progress in the stages of learning how to be an adult. Overprotection of parents. It usually affects dependent people who have been overprotected by their families and haven't developed the necessary skills to confront life. So when they finally arrive to adulthood, they flop. At work, they're getting responsibility. I'll just do the menial stuff. I don't want to grow up in my company. I don't want to take on more tasks. Why? Because that affects what I want to do instead of what I need to do. That I need to become a responsible adult. So the Peter Pans of present society see the adult world as very problematic and glorify adolescence, which is why they want to stay in the state of privilege. I don't want to grow up. I like Neverland. I like flying around and fighting Captain Hook. And the sad thing is that it says that more men than women are affected, but it can affect both sexes. But it appears more often among men. Here's some of the characteristics. Inability of individuals to take on responsibilities. Inability to commit themselves or to keep promises. Excessive care about the way they look, personal well-being, and their lack of self-confidence. Even though they don't seem to show it, and actually come across as exactly the opposite. I remember going to school. It was crazy what I did. I'd go to middle school. I'd leave the house and my hair would be parted this way. But when I go to school, I want to look cool and fit in with the skaters and, you know, have the baggy pants and stuff on. And I'd part my hair in the middle. But when I got back home before I went to the door, I'd, why don't we do those things? We want to fit in. They're saying these people that have this don't want to grow up, they don't want to accept responsibilities, and they still want to dress, and in their mind, they're still like that teenager. They just don't know how to grow up. They don't know what to do. That they constantly change partners, looking for younger ones. The guy that's always got to have a younger girl. Why? Because he thinks he can get away with it. He says, oh, she's not going to put me to the task. She's not going to say, you need to have a better job. You need to be able to support yourself. Involving less future plans. The psychologist says that the only solution for this disease is the right psychological treatment. Come see her and pay her the big bucks. She'll tell you what to do. Pull yourself up by your own bootstraps. Get a better job. Move up, move on with your life. Disease. The only solution for this disease the right psychological treatment. But she doesn't only look for it at that person. She looks at it for that family. What's that family responsible for? Why has this person never grown up? Overprotecting parents can lead children to develop Peter Pan syndrome. How? By not doing what Abraham was told to do. He will command his children and his household after him that they shall keep the way of the Lord. By not teaching, guiding, directing a child to develop necessary skills inflicts harm. In Romans it says, love does no harm. So if you think you're protecting your child from the world by doing everything for them, by not teaching them to grow up, you're actually doing them harm. It says that Abraham was chosen. He was chosen by God to do this, to direct his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord. He was a guardian of the way. This is what he's supposed to do. This is how tradition is passed down. This is how the way of the Lord passed down. It was through one to another, by Abraham and his child and his children, passing down, guarding the way of the Lord. Paul says this too. The way of the Lord. Christ says, I am the way. Paul says, I will show you the most excellent way. He's talking about love. What's so neat is, in Paul's letters to the Romans, he says that love fulfilled the law. Remember what Christ said? I came not to abolish the law, but fulfill the law. The way. We have this obligation to practice and teach the way. It's a responsibility that God gave man the very beginning in the garden. He says, take care of this. Take care of this. When God gives you a child, he says, take care of the child. Not overprotecting, not saying, I'm going to protect him from the world and everything that can come across, because we can't control those things. But we can control what we teach our kids and how we raise them to become adults to handle those things when they come. Not only do we have a responsibility to our children, we have a responsibility, I believe, to our neighbors. When we answer the age-old question, am I my brother's keeper? Because we see that there's an increase of pans. There's more pans. More pans. We see them everywhere. These emotionally immature adults of society, people with the mind of a child but are in an adult body, who haven't developed these necessary skills to confront life. And so when you have children raising children, it doesn't work out so good. Why? Because we work with these people. We do business with these people. We live around these people. These people are our neighbors. We've seen an increase of school shooters. A lot of people want to know why. Why are there so many school shooters? Get this one fact here. What lies inside so many school shooters is a deep void of identity and relationship that they tragically seek to fill through nihilistic violence. They go and shoot up schools. Why? Because there's a deep void of identity and relationship. Notice this too, the staggering fact. There's a sobering theme repeated over and over in the biographies of school shooters. The fatherlessness of a broken or never formed family. Fatherlessness. 25 out of 27 shooters. Fatherlessness of a broken home. Never formed a family. It says among the 25 most cited school shooters since Columbine, 75% were reared in broken homes. So we ask ourselves, we look around and say, well, what does Peter Pan have to do with me? They're in your schools. They're in your neighborhoods. They're all around you. This comes from a psychologist, a preeminent expert on school shooters. He found that most come from incredibly broken homes of not just divorce and separation, but also infidelity, substance abuse, criminal behavior, domestic violence, and child abuse. Maybe this pain that they felt from being in a painful environment at home, they wanted to release in a very, very destructive way. One of the scholars who worked with some criminologists after Sandy Hook found the absence of fathers to be one of the most powerful predictors of crimes. I'll say that again. Found the absence of fathers to be one of the most powerful predictors of crimes. If you don't know when a crime is going to happen or who might commit a crime, very good evidence shows it's the ones that who don't have a father, growing up without a father. I had some evidence that shows what else happens when youth grow up without a father. 63% of youth suicides are from fatherless homes. 90% of all homeless and runaway children are from fatherless homes. 85% of all children who show behavior disorders come from fatherless homes. 70% of youths in state-operated institutions come from fatherless homes. 85% of all youths in prison come from fatherless homes. 75% of all adolescent patients in chemical abuse centers come from fatherless homes. These numbers are staggering. They need that role model that fathers can provide, who show them authority and discipline, who teach them to develop self-control and empathy toward others, which they say is a key character trait lacking in violent youth, that self-control and empathy. Tupac Shakur, the rapper, says, "I know for a fact that had I had a father, I'd have some discipline. I'd have more confidence. Your mother can't calm you down the way a man can. You need a man to teach you how to be a man." They need that source of identity father can show them, that healthy masculinity. When they were studying these cases of these school shooters, they said that that's what most of these shooters were struggling with, was a damaged masculinity. They sought to become ultra masculine by equating getting a gun to suddenly have power. Not a shame that so many people were affected by that. See how many people are affected by what's called the Peter Pan syndrome and fatherlessness. So you can have extreme. You can be an overprotective parent, or you can be an absent parent. Both inflict harm. And so that's why we need to be in the Word so much and ask God for answers and for leadership and direction. And that's what Abraham wants to be, that he was chosen by God for that role, that he was responsible for that role. Command his children, his household after him, to keep the way of the Lord. Keep the way of the Lord. If you remember that Peter Pan wasn't the first, it had a sequel to it. Remember Hook? Anybody watch Hook with Robin Williams? That they say Peter Pan actually left Neverland. He left. Why? And when he's, remember how to fly in the movie Hook, he sees the teddy and he starts looking at the teddy bear and he says, "Teddy, Teddy, Daddy, Daddy." He wanted to be a father. I believe that clip is in there somewhere. It might be, I think it's the last video there.
There it is.
Yeah, I ain't gonna lie, I don't know how to do that.
He finds the teddy bear. He remembers that that's why he left Neverland. That's why he grew up. He left Neverland as Peter Pan. He returns as Peter Panning, a business lawyer. And he finds his teddy bear. He looks at the teddy and he remembers why he left Neverland. That was to become a father. But he had forgotten how to fly. And so he remembers being a father, being a dad. He remembers his happy thought. That is his happy thought, about becoming a father, and he's able to fly. So what's the point of all this, you ask? We see a problem, we see all these Peter Pans, we see people shooting up schools. What do we do about it? First of all, we pray. We make sure that we teach our kids what the Word is saying here about the way of the Lord, keeping the way of the Lord. We pray for leadership. But I think God's got something bigger for us. You know, Abraham's name was Exalted Father first. Imagine having the name Exalted Father and not having any kids left. Any kids yet. He's given the name Exalted Father, but didn't have any kids until way later in life. And then God said, I'm going to continue to bless you. I'm going to change your name to Father of Many. I think that's what God wants to tell us here today. That us men can be that father to many. That there's so many broken homes, kids that are growing up without a father. We're not being raised up to being an adult. Us men can do something to help. God wants to call us to do more. That we can be a father to the fatherless. Why? Because he shows us that's who he is. It says about God himself that he is father to the fatherless. And so what can we do to reach out to those young men who don't have the skills to become a man? What can we do? I want you to pray about that. I want you to pray about that. Because our country's not going to fix itself. God calls up for leaders. He calls up for the church to be his voice, the ones who are carrying the way of the Lord, to reach out and lift up. Remember, like I told you last Sunday, the only time you look down on somebody is to lift them up. Yes, do we see school shooters? Yes, do we not understand everything that might be happening around us? Do we have the love and capacity to help shape some young man's life? I believe we do. I believe God's calling us to do it. And if you want to pray about that, please, will you come? Will you come and say, yes, I'm going to be the man in my community. Yes, I'm going to be who God wants me to be. Yes, I'm going to raise up my child in the way of the Lord. Yes, I'm going to pray for guidance. Yes, I'm going to pray for direction. But yes, I'm going to pray for my community. What can I do here in my community for those broken homes? For those who don't have a father? For those who are still living in Peter Pan syndrome? That don't have the skills to grow up? Will you help them? Will you be involved with what God's doing? Won't you share your passion and your love and your skills and everything your father has taught you? Won't you share that with someone else? Say, yes, I will do what the Lord wants me to do. Yes, I will follow the Lord. Yes, I will take this to somebody who really desperately needs it happen. Who knows? You might be the one standing in the way of another school shooting. You could be that one that God could. I'm going to pray here at the altar. If the men would like to come down, I'd love to pray for you. I'd love to pray for that strength and hope and love that God wants to pour into your heart to reach out into the community. I'll be praying here at the altar. I'd love to pray for you. Whatever you might be going through, maybe you're having struggles with your child. And you say, Lord, I need to have the answers. Lord, I need to have the direction. Lord, I need to have the hope. Lord, will you teach me the way so I can teach others? Lord, I see all these problems in the world, and I don't know what to do about them. Lord, can I be a piece of what you want to do? Can I be a light inside my community? Can I bring hope again to this fallen nation and to this fallen community? Lord, use me. Use me for your will. Lord, help me to be a great father. Lord, show me the way. Help me to raise up my son and daughter the way that you have them to be. Come now. Lord, I pray for everyone that's bowed here in this place. Lord, we know that you want to do a great work, Lord. Lord, I pray that you implant a vision. Implant a vision into our hearts, Lord, of how we can act and be where we are, helping those who are hurting. Lord, implant that vision into our hearts. Lord, it says, without a vision, people perish. Lord, I pray that you just implant that vision in our hearts now. Allow us to see what you want to do. That you are such a great God who can move mountains. Lord, we know that struggles are tough. Lord, we know that sometimes we don't know how to handle a situation. Maybe a situation with our kid at school or some of the problems that they're going through, Lord. But we know that you have all the answers, Lord. You're the solution to every problem. Continue to guide us in your truth, Lord. Continue to guide us in your life. Lord, reveal your plans to us. Let us know what you have for us, Lord. Let us be a part of that. Call us to your great work, Lord. Thank you for everyone that has come up today, making their desires known to be more close to you, Lord, to hear your voice clear, to understand your ways, Lord. Lord, help us take what you give us and give it to others, Lord. Lord, we thank you for everything that you're doing and are going to do. In Jesus' name we pray, give thanks. Amen.
Amen.
I think I know why they put a hole in the guitar. It's to catch some of the picks that you drop. Well, therefore, there's a backup. I keep more of these on the guitar. Just in case something does drop. Let's see what the board. Closer walk with me.
I am weak without. pleasure walk with thee?
Anybody else?
I'm just thankful I have a dad.